Hey guys, how the hell are you? It's that time of year again. The year is drawing to a close. We're about to welcome the brand new year with open arms. But first, I want to talk to you guys about my top 10 favorite new releases that came out in 2021. So a lot of you guys know that I hold new music in very, very high regard. I keep it in a very, very warm, cozy place in my heart. I'm always looking to check out new stuff coming out from some of my favorite bands, of which there were a few that came out this year. Oddly enough, I didn't really gel with some of those. I actually found a little bit more comfort and a little bit more appreciation for some stuff that came out of left field this year, which was pretty awesome. And that brings me to the next thing. I love checking out new stuff and figuring out, okay, where is my new favorite music going to come from? Is it something tried and true, or is it something brand spanking new that I've never come across before? And one of the things that I wanted to talk to you guys about really briefly, for those of you guys that don't know, I do have a Spotify playlist that I update every single week without fail. It is the Arnold Plays Guitar's new release radar. I'm updating this thing every single week, adding the new releases that are coming out that I think are worth checking out. You guys know me. You guys know it's going to be mostly metal. I don't typically add in a lot of mainstream stuff, but if there's something that I think is interesting, I'll add it in. Likewise, I'm also going to add in some stuff from time to time that might not necessarily be metal, but might be something that I can still appreciate. So occasionally you'll find the odd like synthwave project that makes its way in there, maybe some sort of poppy rock thing that makes its way in there. Who knows? But either way, it's going to be stuff that I think is worth checking out. And I definitely would appreciate if you guys would head to Spotify, give that playlist a follow. Like I said, updating every single week. You never know when you're going to find your next favorite band, your next favorite album. So definitely give that playlist a follow. Every time it's updated, hit shuffle, see what you discover. But now, without further ado, let's go into my top 10 releases of this year. I'm going to try to keep it a little bit brief, just kind of give you a full rundown of the albums that came out. So first of all, at number 10, I'd like to talk about Archspire's Bleed the Future. Archspire is a band that in the past I've liked, I've loved, I've always thought that they've put out sound, awesome, high quality stuff, but never something that's really just kind of hit me like this record did. Now, here's the thing. It's something that a few of my metalhead friends have kind of taken issue with in the past with this band is that they sort of play fast and play brutal for the sake of it. And that is kind of what you're getting into here. This is the fastest, most technical death metal imaginable for the sake of it. You don't go into an Archspire release because you want any sort of dynamics or subtlety, even though there is a little bit here. What you go into an Archspire record for is you want stuff that is played super fast, super brutal, super technical, even from the standpoint of the vocalist, and you want something that is just kind of ridiculous for the sake of it. And in that, there's honestly a sort of whimsy that comes through in the delivery of any Archspire record, and this record was no exception. In my opinion, this record has some of the best songs they've ever put out, definitely has the best mix job they've ever had, and all that combined with the performances makes this just kind of an incredible record from them. Next up at number 9 is Grima's Rotten Garden. Something about this record is just special, man. Something about this group is just special. It's a couple of twins that play this really awesome atmospheric blackened metal. Straight up about as atmospheric as black metal can get. Really just kind of evokes that whole forest and nature theme that kind of permeates the record both lyrically and also in terms of the overall vibe of the record. They're not afraid to slow it down, bring in a lot more melody, a lot more atmosphere, interplay with a little bit of keyboards in there, but it is what it is. It's just a solid damn record that's super melodic that you can get lost in. I almost wish I had this thing on vinyl because, man, this would be kind of an experience. Put this thing on vinyl, really hear the warmth coming from the speakers, and just kind of lose yourself in it. That's that kind of record, to be honest with you. Next up is Echoes of the Soul by Crypta. Now, this one was one that I was kind of holding out for. I loved Nervosa. I always thought that they were a fantastic band. So when that sort of split happened a while back, I was kind of downtrodden about that. I was like, man, but they were coming out with some incredible tunes and they were only getting better with each successive record. So what's going to happen now? Well, the new Nervosa record came and went and not that impressed with that. So I was really, really hoping that this record was going to be killer, and I was not disappointed. It is what it is. It's a couple former members of Nervosa. It's a former member of Burning Witches, and they together have crafted just an incredible old-school death metal record. Yeah, you've got some thrashy elements in there from the previous outings that they've done together, but man, this is just goddamn solid stuff, especially if you're into like the old school death metal like Benediction, Bolt Thrower, some stuff on there that sounds like old school Deicide. This is just kind of a damn solid record from start to finish. A lot of standout cuts on this record. And nothing really to find at fault with it. It's just great. And number seven, I want to talk about Costellon by Slaughter to Prevail. Now, this is one of those records that it's an awesome deathcore record. Sure, this Russian band has come out with something incredible. There's always going to be a lot of people out there that sort of poo-poo this sort of record because there's a little bit of mainstream cred attached to it. And that being the fact that lead singer Alex Terrible is a YouTuber who's kind of known at this point for his vocal stylings, for having a sort of extreme guttural vocal delivery. And so everyone's always going to be like, oh, well, they're only famous because of, but you know what? Fuck it, dude. This record is kind of fucking awesome. The breakdowns are ridiculous. The blasting parts are really well crafted. There's those moments on there, like on Demolisher, where everyone knows what moment I'm talking about, too, if you've seen any sort of like vocal coach react videos that are present on YouTube. Everyone knows the moment I'm talking about, where it just comes out of nowhere, hits you like a brick in the face, like, oh God, this guy can fucking do this. This record is kind of chock full of those moments, and honestly, it's such a killer, violent record if you sort of leave out any sort of like, oh, it's because of this, and just fucking sit down and listen to it, you find an incredible listening experience. At number six, we've got Noctambulist, The Barren Form. Oddly enough, this year, I had two releases from two separate bands called Noctambulist that I loved, that were both on my sort of like short list of my favorite records, trying to whittle down, okay, what do I like more than the other? And ultimately, this one was one that won out. The other Noctambulist is a post-blackened metal band. That record was very, very much worth checking out. You guys know I dig the post-black metal stuff, but this one just kind of won out for me. Brutal, angry, pummeling, and aggressive death metal. Plenty of blasting, plenty of shrieking, plenty of growling. They also have a tendency to embrace a lot of dissonance. There's a lot of tension that just is built up from all these dissonant passages, but they also are not afraid to embrace that tension and not give release to it. It's just tense for the sake of it, while still being brutal, while still being angry, and that leads to a really killer listening experience too. So definitely, if you want that sort of brutal fix that's still relatively underground, this is definitely the record that kind of did it for me this year. Next up, at number five, we definitely have to talk about Diorama from Mole. So this was kind of an interesting year for post-black metal because, like, this was, it was just weird. You would think with all that's going on in the world, this would be kind of a feeding frenzy. Like, there's so much anger, there's so much sadness and depression that there would be a lot of killer new releases coming out, and there were some. But this was also the weird year where Def Heaven, a band that I actually rather enjoy, just said, you know what, fuck it, we're going full on The Cure and we're just gonna write nothing but songs about paintings and fucking daffodils. Luckily, Diorama came along and this was a killer, killer post-blackened metal release that came out. In that it's still got plenty of metal. It's extremely riff heavy. There's still a lot of dynamics. They're not afraid to go into, you know, their electro harmonics shelves and figure out what sort of flanger and delay effects they want to do to make these sort of weird shoegazy passages. But they use them extremely effectively and they only give way to the brutal heavy riffage once again. It's just an absolutely killer post-black metal record. Black gaze, if you really want to call it that. But not eschewing the heaviness. Oh my god, finally someone fucking did it. Just, ooh man, what a great record. And truthfully, almost could put it even higher on the list. It was just kind of late in the year and I felt by this point, you know, the records I'm about to talk about just kind of held a little bit more of a place in my heart is all. For number four, we're going to talk about Night Therapy 1, which is the debut full length from a band called Hurtwave. It's not metal at all. It's just got such an extremely cool and calming vibe to it. I oddly found out about this band from an Instagram ad that showed up. Unmuted it and was like, wow, this is really, really catchy. I love the synth parts. It's a synth pop record done by a bunch of guys that have been in various screamo and pop punk bands back in the day. And it's just one of those things that if you get into synthwave, if you get into cool wave, if you get into that sort of genre and you want that sort of vibe, but you still want something poppy and uber hook-driven to sort of latch onto, this was a killer record and it definitely was just sort of nice to listen to in those moments where I'm like, you know what, I just want to relax, I want to chill out. This is a fantastic record for that. And number three, Gizmachi is a band that I first saw at Ozfest 2005. I thought they were really cool. I loved what they were doing because it was so radically different from what everyone else on that tour was doing. It was kind of a breath of fresh air that day, not gonna lie. And I just remember thinking, man, this is really cool. This is really interesting. It's intricate. It's still brutally heavy. There's a lot of syncopation here. There's going to be a lot for people to latch onto. And I think what happened is, being that it was 16 years ago, I think they were just kind of not coming out at the right time. If they would have come out maybe another 5-6 years later, people would have been like, oh my God, this is mind-blowing. But back then, everyone just kind of didn't really know what to do with it. Fast forward 16 years later, I hope it's not too late for them because this record was mind-blowingly good. Okay, Omega Kaliad, I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Such a killer record, exactly the kind of follow-up that I was hoping for from these guys. This time with a different vocalist. Speed Strid from Soilwork is handling the microphone duties on this record, and he brings a really, really killer delivery to these angular, ridiculously syncopated riffs. I mean, it's just pummeling. It's just brutal and pummeling without necessarily needing to resort to blasting or shrieks or anything like that. It's just super fucking heavy, pile-driving riffage throughout. And if that's the sort of thing you get into, this is a incredible record that you need to check out. Number two, also veering off a little bit off of the familiar path here, but this was a record that I just couldn't deny the power of. I think the band's name is pronounced Kreia or Cray or something like that. A killer album-oriented poppy rock record that's heavy, it's melodic, it's something you can super latch onto if you're into like the sort of stuff from back in the day, like we're talking Journey, Hardline. It's definitely got that same sort of vibe. You know, plenty of atmosphere, just that right kind of like refrigerator rack full of guitar processors kind of tone that's coming out. Super awesome mix job there too. Great singer, great performances all around. Never overplaying, always just playing something that totally fits the sound. Songs like Find a Reason, Siberia. These songs are some of my favorites on the record. It's just super poppy, super catchy. And if you don't mind something that is so hook-laden, this is a killer record that you should not sleep on. And finally, in the number one slot, god damn, there was something special about this record right off the bat. And it's also something that, truthfully, with how much great stuff came up later on in the year, I was like, man, do I really want to put out a record at the top of my list that came out so early on in this year? And, you know, I kind of felt like at the end I had no choice but to, because it's still something that when it comes on my shuffle in the car, I'm like, yep, I'm not skipping this. It's so fucking good. I just love it. Dress Code Blood from Mordcall. Okay, this is a record I feel like everyone I talk to slept on this record. It's so good. It's so incredible. It's... damn. Like, what's the best way I can describe this? Okay, it is the single best record to come out in their subgenre since Slaughter of the Soul. I'm putting it out there right now. There's been a lot of incredible Melodeath, death thrash, whatever the hell you want to call it, bands that have come out. They've come and gone. They've left behind legacies of incredible records, sometimes not so incredible records. Sometimes they've devolved into sort of new metal-y, metalcore-y bands. Others have flown the flag, you know, loud and proud and stayed true to the genre that they love. But through it all, not a single record has hit me in this subgenre as hard and just so perfectly. I mean, perfect. Everything about this record is perfect. The riffs, the vocal delivery, the guitar tone, the mix job, like the way everything sits in there, how everything just has that perfect amount of underground brutality and heaviness while still being catchy enough in terms of the overall riff. The riff, man. Ooh, these guys are masters of the fucking riff. This is the best record in this genre since Slaughter of the Soul. And fuck, dude, if that's not enough to justify putting it at the top of my year-end list, and to also please implore you guys to stop sleeping on this record and to check it out because it was that fucking good, then I don't know what to tell you. I loved this record. It was so awesome. I still jam it. Like I said before, I can't even pick a favorite song on this record. I really can't. Maybe Bring Me Her Head. I love that. You know what? But no, but the title track is really fucking good too. Fuck. It's just a great record. And I know I'm going off the rails here, going on a rant. So I'm going to end it there. You guys, please don't sleep on these 10 releases that came out. You know, I know that a lot of these are names that you maybe are not seeing or hearing in a lot of the other year-end lists that are coming out. So, you know, I'm not trying to be like, you know, super true and, you know, like, oh, I have such awesome hipster metal taste compared to everybody else. But it's just, these are the records that just sort of had an effect on me this year. And definitely, definitely, definitely want to share them with you guys, as is the whole purpose of this video. I want to put their names out there. I want to put the names of these records out there so that hopefully you guys find something new and awesome to latch on to. With that being said, also, please remember to follow my Spotify playlist. I am going to be updating it every single week so you guys can check out as much new stuff as possible. As always, remember to like, subscribe, comment down in the comment section below. There is tons more metal and guitar-oriented content to come. And as always, please remember, take what you do seriously, but do not take yourselves too seriously.